I'm going to talk today for maybe about half an hour, 40 minutes or so, about an area of conflict. It's not really the wider territory of the Northern Irish Peacewalls. I'm going to talk specifically about the Peacewalls in Belfast. And they've had a 50th birthday anniversary just recently. So I think it's an interesting time to look back on the 50-year impact of the Peacewalls on the city. And we like to get very situated and localized. So I'm going to really concentrate on a piece of territory in West Belfast between the Falls Road and the Shankill Road. So we're going to hopefully try and zoom in very definitely in our Zoom session. And I'm going to start with a piece of video, which I hope is you're going to be able to see. It's just over 50 years ago. Last September, this piece of footage was recorded, and it's actually a piece of footage about the very first peace line going in on the streets of Belfast. And you'll notice there are a number of different operators in the sequence. There are local British Army engineers who are actually putting stakes into the ground at this particular location. There is the general officer commanding of the British Army, General Freeland, who is the head of operations. And then there are a number of local people from both sides of this territory, what would be considered Protestant and Catholic sides of this particular piece of territory. So I'll just share that with you. It's about 3 minutes long, and that will set the scene, I hope, as that's the kind of very birth of the thing that we'll be discussing.
James, you don't have your share screen on.
Okay. Okay, you can see my screen, I hope, at this point.
Yeah, that's right.
So I'm just going to start it a little bit into the clip.
Peaceline zigzags between the troubled centre of Belfast, the Protestant Shankill Road, and the Catholic Falls Road area. It is now complete except in one place, Dover Street, the shortest direct route between the Protestant and Catholic strongholds and the scene of August's fighting. At first, the army moved in to build their peace line on the site of the Protestant barricade. Work proceeded smoothly. But soon, there were Protestant protests. If the peace line were built on their barricade, some Protestants would be stranded in a Catholic area. Work stopped while the army checked with headquarters. General Freeland, commander of the British troops, arrived to inspect the line. The line had been agreed the previous day between Protestants and Catholics at Belfast City Hall. The army had no say in its placing.
We've had a hold up for some reason, they've just seen about it.
Hey, keep on track.
But soon, General Freeland was to face what his troops have been facing these past 5 weeks.
What's it, materials or exactly where to put it?
Exactly where to put it, I think, sir.
Can I speak?
Of course you can, everybody.
Well, we live in Beverly Street.
Oh, yeah.
This is Beverly Street down here. What's that putting a barrier here for?
And that street there neither.
And us land, yes.
I think we better leave it to whoever's arranging it.
Yeah, well,
wait a second. Wait a second, hold to see about it.
Oh, have they gone now? Are they? Oh, yeah.
That's great. Talk.
We want to try and get everybody to agree where to put it.
Yes, but this was arranged in the City Hall, sir, yeah. Where the barrier was going.
Was it?
Between the councillors.
Well, they're the people who've got to say where to put it, because we don't know.
Yes, they have already said where to put it. And that is the wrong place.
I see.
And I have tried to tell them all morning.
I see. I see. Well, they probably don't quite know. We'll sort it out. Don't worry. We'll go further down.
This was only the beginning of the continuing story of the Dover Street peace line. Dover Street is not typical of Belfast, but then neither were the mobs who came along it in August and brought Northern Ireland near to civil war.
Okay, so we'll just leave that clip there. So this location is the corner of Dover Street and Beverly Street now. It looks exactly like this. This is a photograph from about 5 years ago now. But yeah, this kind of transition from a piece of unrolled barbed wire to this pretty monumental division barrier running through the west of the city. I'm going to try and unpack that a little bit and hopefully explain to you how we got into this kind of situation. Of course, it's important to understand that this is just one of numerous barriers and so-called peace walls throughout the city of Belfast. Belfast Interface Project, who are a local agency, have actually mapped a total of 99 interfaces, boundaries, gates, and barriers, and so on across the city. But the actual number of the peace walls is an element of dispute, like so many different things in Belfast. So let's just have a quick unpacking of the strange, probably misnomer, the word peace wall. A peace wall is actually a war wall. And it's an incredible set of walls and barriers which form an urban system of division throughout the city of Belfast. They're quite distinct and they have their own identity. They're very different from things like the Berlin Wall, in that they're not kind of continuous running and separating the city into two sections or anything. There are lots of smaller, multiple, and I suppose multifarious things that kind of join together in very, very strange ways, and sometimes then just completely stop and are taken up at different points throughout the city. So they're really ad hoc, and they're really ad hoc in their materials. Some of them are quite old now. So over the 50 years they've been there, you get this kind of material register of changes of materials and additions, and generally things are being built higher and longer as time has gone on. It's important to note that also some of them are completely invisible and imperceptible, particularly if you're not local to the area, you may not understand that there's a particular kind of boundary condition, but it would be very well understood locally. So this is just some of the peace walls in black here. These ones are particularly showing the one in West and North Belfast. So you can see on the right-hand side is the jagged line of the River Lagan and the Docklands. The grey part is really the city centre as such, and the dark rectangle within it is City Hall. So that will give you a little reference for some of the maps and things we'll be showing you as we proceed. So I'm going to start and talk about a very particular piece of territory. And this is the one that we have been looking at. And you can see this territory that the video was recorded in is basically between the Shankill Road and the Falls Road. And there was this really fantastic piece of research conducted in 1967 into very early 1968, before any of the troubles broke out in Northern Ireland. And Fred Boal noticed that there seemed to be a kind of natural borderline occurring at Cooper Street. So he measured things like flags that were happening in the street around the celebrations of the 12th of July, which is celebrations for the Orange Order. And he also did things like trying to understand where people did the main parts of their grocery shopping and where they spent their money. So on the left-hand side here, you have basically the Catholic side of Cooper Street. And you could see that people, although it might be nearer to go shopping on the northern part of this territory, everybody just south of that street tended to do their shopping in Clonard in the Falls. And then on the right-hand side, you have a similar thing where people on the Protestant side of the street, so-called, would do their shopping in the Shankill, even though shops might be closer to the southern side of the street. So it's a really insightful piece of research about a kind of behavioral attitude that was already existing in Belfast at the time. And it was to do with like boundaries being understood between the different communities in the city, even though they may not be demarcated in any way. So this particular piece of territory then became a really contentious piece of ground. And during the riots in Belfast in 1969, a lot of the buildings, particularly around Bombay Street, were set on fire. And this is the scene on Bombay Street and Kashmir Street at that time. And you can see that actually a lot of the houses in the neighborhood have been completely set on fire or in a kind of ruinous state. And this is very directly adjacent to that area that was surveyed by Fred Ball 1 or 2 years earlier. So you can see some of the devastation, interestingly, in these overhead photographs, but also you can see a lot of debris and material on the streets, some of which will start to become more ad hoc barricades and informal kind of gateways to particular parts of the city here that formed kind of perimeter conditions. So this is on Conway Street, and you're looking down the street from the Falls towards the Shankill, and you can see actual barricades on the Falls side of the street, and then there's another barricade further down on the Shankill side. So you start to have these two quite distinct territories being set up with a kind of no man's land in the middle. Quite naturally, the two communities on either side were organizing these barricades. So the riots in Belfast at the time were kind of really unprecedented, and you see some of the documents here trying to just document what was happening and the steps that the government needed to take. And you can see a kind of solidification of the boundary conditions around the Lower Falls using different kinds of materials, lots of stuff that was there to hand, but also you have the army coming along with knife rests and barbed wire and so on. And you can see that in Stormont, they're really trying to kind of deal with the situation. You can see on the 16th of August 1969 is the first reference I can kind of see on any policy document. And they talk about the possibility of sealing off access to the Falls from the Shankill to prevent infiltration. So that's on the 16th of August 1969. And all over the city, you can see, you know, the different kind of perimeter conditions that were solidifying at this point in time. And it was one of the largest movements of people across Europe since the Second World War. People were actively moving across from different sides of this territory. And then on the 9th of September, there was a general announcement about the establishment of a so-called peace line. And you can see that the peace wall is kind of inserted into this territorial condition as a kind of exchange, so that there will be an official police peace line inserted into the territory on the condition of all of the barricades being removed from that area. So once this was announced, you actually had a huge kind of migration of people who would swap houses from different parts of the city and so on. So it was an incredible mobile situation. And then subsequently, 1971, you have this policy document which really sets out what's going to happen with the peace walls throughout Belfast for the next 30, 40, 50 years. And so you have the first map, really, which starts to locate the very first peace line. And the Shankill Road would be on the north side of this map, and the falls would be on the southern side. So you can see, even at that point in 1971, you have quite a considerable part of the city is just completely divided off from one another. So just let's look at the wider context a little bit. I mean, this is quite an amazing map from INCOR, a group at the University of Ulster, and in trying to visualize the conflict known as the Troubles, they've actually mapped the individual deaths. So this is actually a map of Belfast indicating every single person that was killed over this time period. And you can see the densest part of this map is the area that we have just been looking at. And of course, things escalated quite quickly after the riots of 1969, particularly in 1972, Bloody Sunday. You then had direct rule from Westminster. So the territory used to be governed from Stormont in Northern Ireland, and rule then became instructed from London here. So there was a kind of an ungoverning, I suppose, of the situation, and a removal of the local governance to London governance, which was really important. And then Bloody Friday in Belfast itself in 1972, 22 bombs went off all over the city. So this also had a real impact on the kind of the need for, I suppose, territorial control from the army point of view. 1972, also Operation Motorman. And this is trying to kind of take back some of the so-called no-go areas and make them, accessible again to the army and the forces. So I'm going to look very specifically now at one single kind of boundary condition. Again, it's in similar territory. It's this interface between Bombay Street and Kashmir Street. And you can see in 1969, it goes from a condition of having like bits of old cars, abandoned vehicles, lorries and so on, bricks and so on. And then just 2 years later, you start to see the barbed wire, which you saw being installed in the very first piece of footage, and then some of this corrugated sheeting, which became, you know, a very early condition of the peace wall. And this is obviously the exact same location. So here you can see the very first iteration of the peace wall along Cooper Way. This is building the very edges of the first peace wall. So they started at the eastern and western edges and moved in towards the center to make a complete piece of wall construction. By 1979, you can see that there's concrete blocks, scaffold poles. The corrugated iron has become higher again, and you get a complete masking off of any kind of visual connection across between the communities on either side. And also you have things like block wall and concrete wall being built, and extensions in a metal bar and so on. And then much more fixed, again, much more permanent, actual poured concrete panels, steel I sections, and much more rigid metal sheeting replacing the corrugated iron previously. This is that very same wall in 2014. So you can still see the concrete base from the previous image, and you can still see that very first section of the metal sheeting, but now that has been further extended upwards by a kind of metal mesh sheeting. Sometimes it's transparent and sometimes it's completely opaque. And you know, it's just completely denies any kind of contact, any kind of connection across this single street. So this is actually the same junction, pretty much 50 years or so apart. This is looking down towards Bombay Street, and Kashmir Road is the junction that you see. So it's worth noting that the Cooper Way wall, which is what we've just been charting the development of, has been around for much longer and is much higher than many perhaps more famous wall conditions. So, and this is that same wall now, and you can get a sense of the scale of it just from these local kids marking and painting on the surface of the wall. So I was just going to talk about maybe a typology of the interface walls. A lot of people think that the walls only really started being built in Belfast in 1969. But this is the very first peace wall, I would say, so-called, from 1866. And this is a 9-foot deep brick wall that was actually built underground in the Belfast City Cemetery to separate Catholic and Protestant bodies in the city cemetery. So this gap that you can see between the gravestones is actually the location of a long length of brick wall that's been built underground. It's quite a strange piece of construction by any means. But even as early as 1922, there were walls being built, to try and deal with difficult riotous situations all over the city. There's been kind of sequences of clashes in Belfast going back for a long, long time. So from the 20s, this one was built in the 30s in Sailor Town area of Belfast. So this one stayed up for quite some time and then was removed subsequently. The early ones from the 60s were really like a mishmash of lots of different kinds of material conditions. This is a photograph from the Maloney collection. And even though this piece of wall doesn't exist anymore, you can really get a sense of how it's built of lots of different bits and pieces. And the later ones, I think, are much more unified. They're much more continuous. They're probably built in one single section over a number of months, which this one was built in along Alliance Avenue in North Belfast. And of course, some of the peace walls are temporary. They're erected for very particular scenarios and situations. So this one was erected in Bryson Street in 2012, just to deal with very local riots and so on that were happening there. And this is probably the latest version of the peace wall. It's like a version where its materiality really starts to try to disappear. And it is effectively a kind of mesh fence designed to be as invisible as possible, but it stops missiles and things being thrown over the wall. This one is also interesting in terms of technological advancement because it's designed to be retractable. So it can actually be taken up and down. I think the only difficulty with that is that nobody could decide who was going to be in charge of its retractability. So it's actually stayed up from the time it was inserted, and it still is in this condition. So let's have a look at the urban form, because it's important to see what's happening all over the space of the city. And really, from very early in, from the start of the city's development, in a way, there was a sense of it being a center of defensive architecture. So you can see the red line here is the actual wall around the city. And the two roads leaving the city on the western side are actually the Shankill and the Falls Road. So I'm going to present a series of overlays which tries to give you an impression of the development of the walls and also the relationship of the city centre itself to the kind of hinterlands and other areas. So this charts like the map of many different events and riots that have happened throughout the city. So you can see that a lot of them are actually happening along the Falls and the Shankill on the western edge, going back to 1857 and periodically throughout history right up until 1980 is the latest date of this map. And also a major impact on the city centre is the imposition of the Belfast Urban Motorway. So the red line here is the motorway that actually encircled the city from the late 60s onwards. And actually that created a kind of hinterland of dereliction all around the edges of the motorway, because land was just left and buildings were just left. And that actually created a real, how would you say, like the center of the city and the periphery really became separated by this gap of derelict land in a way. So you can see these are the areas along the Folds and the Shankill that the video referred to. So the lines of connection of the streets between them became this kind of disputed territory. And this is the location of that very first peace wall in 1969-1970. So you can see it's inserted very directly to try and relate and separate the two areas. Also concurrently, of course, there was all kinds of different events, actions and so on happening in the city, lots of explosions centrally. The large orange ones are all of the explosions that happened on one day on Black Friday. So as a result, there was a decision to make a ring of steel around the very, very center of the city and make it very difficult to get in and out. People had to be checked and so on going in and out of the city center. So you almost had this kind of fortified condition separating the center. The motorway, in a sense, acted as a kind of moat condition, effectively. And then you had this external kind of hinterland which became really derelict and unloved. And you had to kind of, you know, jump over major derelict areas to get from the center to the outskirts. And this is a kind of urban condition that's really still problematic to this day. So you have, you know, these areas of blight, what are now currently car parks, still encircling the whole of the city. And as a result, you know, the discrepancy, I suppose, between central Belfast as an urban area and the areas outside are much, much less unloved. They're much more underfunded and so on. And so as a result, you can see most of the peace walls and areas of conflict are actually outside this kind of neo-fortified zone at this point. So let's just look at the impact of some of these walls and their adjacent areas. So this is the ring of steel that I was just talking about. So it's actually a proper steel kind of entrance way into the city. So entrance in and out of the streets was actually reduced to a very finite amount of entries. And this is the construction of the urban motorway. And you can really see how it completely cuts into the ground of the city and very much separates the center from the north and western parts, creating this just expanse of derelict land, which was completely unloved and, you know, just left abandoned for long periods of time. So you have a condition where, you know, the walls in the city almost kind of appear, you know, to me in certain cases when I look at maps, it's almost like a kind of scarification of the city. You know, roads are truncated. You get very strange conditions where a road might come up against a peace line and be turned around in some way. So you actually trying to get from one location to another is actually very, very difficult in many locations. And of course you have a kind of, I suppose, concentration of a certain kind of identity. So the shot on the left here is a memorial space on the Falls Road, and the shot on the right is a memorial space on the Shankill Road. So you get all kinds of cues in the landscape, from flags to bits of iconography to markings on the street, you know, that describe a kind of an outline, a territorial condition in a way. One of which is obviously very rooted in a kind of Irish Republican nationalism, and on the other side, very much loyal to the British Crown. yeah, and a unionist worldview. So I think it's important just to understand the impact on the walls, on the city, in terms of the psychological impact. You know, they became real targets during riotous conditions and so on, and you actually could read the overlay of some of these events very, very directly on the materiality of the walls over time. And also the physical fabric of the city around the peace walls and the interface areas. You actually had a lot of dereliction and then the buildings being completely removed. So you had large areas of open space, reducing the density of the city and actually making it more dangerous, because it wasn't as occupied as before, and you don't have a sense of a kind of passive surveillance from people being there and occupying the space. So in certain areas, like this is a map of the Short Strand on the very left-hand side, which is in East Belfast, but they would see themselves almost like as an enclave community. So within, you have a very tight-knit Catholic community, and then towards the east, you have a very large and expansive Protestant community. And I think it's interesting that it actually, you know, it's very much, I think, related to a kind of defensive architectural condition. I think this, you know, the diagram of the Charles Fort in Cork, which is where I'm from, I think is, you know, an interesting kind of resonance across the two images. And over time, this is also the Short Strand. You had areas of the city that were very much, you know, you could move through the city. It was a grid condition. It was very open. And on the right-hand side, you see that over time, a lot of the fabric of the city is actually reduced. The entrances to areas are reduced down to a minimal amount of number, and you actually get lots of cul-de-sacs. And you know, the entry and I suppose the passive surveillance is kind of changed in condition. So this is that same part of the city, and showing a little bit wider. This is David Cole's research, but I think really fascinating also to see how a kind of open grid condition from pre-1969 gets completely truncated and shut down into like a kind of labyrinth of cul-de-sacs in a way over time. So you have conditions like this where you have houses and literally at their back garden you have fences that are higher than the houses themselves. It's quite kind of strange. I think if you've not been there to see it, it can be really kind of bizarre situation to find yourself in sometimes. And of course, these areas are now quite heavily surveyed. So, you know, the surveillance around the city is extensive and very much readable in the landscape. You know, you're very much aware of the fact that you're being viewed through video cameras consistently throughout any of the time that you can, you know, walk around in the urban space here. I mean, it also leads to very strange, you know, layerings of the space. So this is in Upper Springfield, where you have these superheroes painted onto the actual part of the peace line. And of course, they're actually bursting through and eliminating the peace line. But of course, it is this kind of magical fantasy condition. And of course, directly adjacent to this, you know, marking on a flank wall of a building of a massacre that had happened, you know, in the 60s in the area. And the sign on the upper right-hand side here, this is just to try and mark, in a way, the psychological impact of these spaces on both residents and visitors. I think I've often had the feeling of almost wandering through a kind of post-traumatic landscape, in a way, in trying to map and document these areas. So let's look at some of the the actual governance and policy surrounding the peace walls. 2011, there was a major change in the program for government for the Northern Ireland Executive. And in 2013, they actually made the policy, which you can see there under our safe community, to create a 10-year program to reduce and remove by 2023 all interface barriers. This is across the whole of Northern Ireland. So quite a significant task to try and remove these in 10 years. And you can see various bits of policy and different kinds of fragmented administrations that have been trying to tackle this issue in the intervening years. And there's been lots of statistics and so on about, you know, trying to understand from both locals and visitors, local residents, their attitudes to the peace walls. 82% believe the peace walls are ugly. 78% believe that segregation of communities is common, even when there are no peace walls, and so on. So there was a real sense of the need for change in these areas. So you have lots of these very local kinds of gatherings together about from local residence groups, local, I suppose, groups that are trying to have an impact on the peace wall situation, community groups, the Belfast Interface Project are very much involved in this, and trying to kind of engender a dialogue between the top-down governmental agencies, primarily the Department of Justice, who are responsible for a lot of the walls, and the local communities to try and secure agreement about how the walls can be removed by consent over this period of time. So this was the first chink in the armor, in a way, at Workman Avenue, which is to the very west of the map we have been looking at. Again, between the falls and the Shankill, really, further west. But yeah, this was in 2013. You had the removal of a piece of the wall, and it was so opaque that you couldn't really see into the adjacent community. And it was replaced by this gate, which was transparent and allowed a certain kind of visual permeability through into the spaces. So even though the wall stays in place, that kind of permeability was seen as a really positive change in the area. Certain gates were allowed to stay open for the first time in decades. This one through Alexandra Park. And then around Girdwood, which is a former British Army site, there was a really interesting opportunity with the new Girdwood Centre there, where they removed the whole perimeter condition, which completely, radically transformed this whole part of North Belfast. I mean, I think what's really interesting here is with the removal of the wall, suddenly you get this expansive sense of being able to see the horizon, which psychologically is actually really profound. And just the sense of immediacy across once the wall is removed is quite amazing. So here you can get a real sense of that, just, you know, taking out this metal fence completely extends the kind of psychological horizon in this space. So I think it's fair to say that you know, the removal of walls has been very slow and steady. You know, the actual target of trying to remove all the walls by 2023 is clearly at this point not going to be met. The fact that the Northern Ireland Executive was not operational for the past 3 years and has just been, back in action really since last January of 2020, put a real impediment, I would say, in trying to get things organized to be able to get policies in place and agreement in place to actually remove walls across Belfast and across Northern Ireland. But it's good to see that there has been, you know, slow, probably incremental change. So just finally, I think it's interesting to have a look at the future condition in these spaces. And it's clear that, you know, these territories in the future must be shared because, you know, the predominant communities in Northern Ireland are very kind of equal in terms of their number and so on. It's not necessarily a binary kind of condition either. There's much more diversity in the population than there would have been certainly in 1969. So how you actually share territory and share space in the city is a key issue, I think, moving forward. This was something I did in 2016, was really trying to look at, you know, what could you actually do and trying to reduce things down to maybe key things that you could look at, which included things like demolishing all the primary and secondary schools in Belfast, which are very much related to religious education, trying to replace them with one single state-of-the-art multi-faith academy actually sited in the space of the peace walls themselves. And I also started to think about ways to try and make connections between, you know, the top-down governance situation and the bottom-up community representation. There's a frequent kind of disconnect between the top-down and the bottom-up in a way. So this was really just before the Northern Ireland Executive disbanded. And I was trying to find a method to really kind of connect through from, you know, top-down and bottom-up, as it were, and actually set out how you might define and plan out, you know, agreements to be able to remove the peace walls in the city. I've actually been looking at this territory much more closely, more recently, to try and see if there are ways to try and thread through and between and knit together across this peace line currently. I think, you know, the policy is obviously to remove all of the peace walls by 2023. But I wonder at this point, would it actually be useful to retain a very small and finite amount of the peace walls as a piece of historical architecture, really with a kind of heritage value, which could demonstrate, you know, we could learn from about, you know, the impact that these walls had, you know, on this area of the city. So I'm trying to look at currently ways to kind of stitch across this line, and maybe what now is a single divisive wall could start to have architectural elements that both kind of plug in and bridge across this kind of space, and over time would allow certain elements of the walls to be completely reduced, and maybe, you know, in 50 years time, you know, very, very small fragments of the walls themselves will be still extant in the city, but they may be kind of preserved, almost like, you know, a kind of museum artifact in a way. So there may be possibilities of actually trying to kind of enclose or, you know, engender a kind of relationship in the spaces adjacent to these walls. Okay, so that's it for me. I'll just finish up with a request that if any of you out there have any kinds of interesting maps or objects or artifacts or anything that you may add to the Peacewall Archive, which I've been developing since 2015, I would love to hear from you. Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you so much, James. That was totally, like, I've never seen any of that research. Is it kind of publicized, or is this your kind of personal archive?
Well, I've been building up the Peacewall Archive, which is available online at peacewall-archive.net, which has various images and maps and historical documentation and so on. But what's up online is really just a kind of fragment, a very small fraction of what I have on various hard drives. So I'm actively working to try and, you know, make it as comprehensive as I can. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you working with the Northern Irish authorities in any way?
Yes, I have. I've had meetings at Stormont, for example, with the Department of Justice, who are in charge of probably the majority of the walls. I've offered my services very freely. I think they're maybe tentative because I think they have a certain kind of program that they're trying to move forward with. In a way, I was trying to maybe suggest certain things or try and advocate for things around the peace walls and try and share the knowledge that I have, really, yes. Mm. But that's an ongoing situation.
Mm. I was thinking about when you were doing the presentation, I was thinking about in terms of the kind of current context at the moment, I guess like systemic racism is a very invisible force, and it has all these kind of these ties across so many different parts of society, and it's just interesting to see how these walls are like physical manifestations of oppression, or like trying to separate different factions of people, and like how does the country heal from that very, very physical. I think it's just how do you kind of feel about the current situation?
I mean, I think the peace walls really are a kind of material reminder of the fact that although there is a peace process that's ongoing in Northern Ireland, there has never really been a process of reconciliation that has, I would say, got to a goal of where these communities still feel like they're able to kind of integrate and communicate. I mean, things are obviously much better, but I think the fact that the peace walls are still there in the city, and there's a certain reluctance to remove them, is an indication in a way that the reconciliation is something that's still being chased after in Northern Ireland, despite, the Good Friday Belfast Agreement being signed in 1988 now, like many years ago. But if you wander around Belfast, you're never really very far from a peace wall across the whole of the city. Mm-hmm. And of course, they're all over other cities and even out in the countryside in certain places in Northern Ireland as well.
Did you do interviews with residents living there?
Yes, I've talked to residents. I've talked to residents groups. There's certain advocacy groups like the Belfast Interface Project who kind of coordinate lots of smaller residents groups and so on throughout the city. So I've tried to move around and look at the problem of the peace walls, I guess, from lots of different points of view as much as possible. I think that's kind of part of the methodology I'm using. Although when I do talk to people, they're probably understandably very reluctant to be recorded as recorded interviews. So I have some absolutely amazing conversations I've had, walking around Belfast and talking to people. But I've rarely been given permission for those to be recorded, unfortunately. I wish I had more.
Mm. If people have questions, do let me know in the chat bar. But yeah, I was also going to ask kind of how this research came about. Like, what you said, you started it in 2015, but was there a kind of impetus to this?
I think the whole kernel of the project, like its seed in a way, started when I went to Belfast for the very first time in 1988. And that was my first time going to the city, despite the fact that I grew up in Cork, down in the south coast of Ireland. Pretty much every night on the TV in Ireland, you would hear about things that were going on in Belfast and the streets of Belfast. And I felt like I had a kind of intimate knowledge of the city before I ever went there. It was bizarre. It's almost like the first time you go to New York or Venice or something like that. You've got this understanding of the place purely through its mediation. Mm. And the very first time We went there. We actually went around, and I was absolutely astonished by the impact, the kind of monumentality of some of the walls in the city. And yeah, I think I just kind of came back to that many years later, in a way, because Kristen, my partner, and I, we do projects that are related, you know, to very particular spaces. And we've got a current project that's been ongoing for a number of years, which is called Ungovernable Spaces, where we're really trying to think about the relationship between community and resistance, and you know, the role of governance in a way. And this seemed to be a really interesting opportunity to kind of look at a very particular situation in a way that's unfolded in the city over time.
Because, like, I guess your proposals that you were putting forward about like placing these follies in and then eventually reducing sections of the wall, and maybe like that's only going to happen if there's some confidence, or like that the government want to do that. Like, they have to be, like, you kind of speak about this like reluctance.
Yeah, I think in some areas, I would say communities are more interested in the peace walls in their locality coming down than in others. In some spaces of the city, they're seen very much like as historical relics of, and reminders of the troubles, and people don't see that they're really necessary any longer. And just recently, some walls have come down on Serpentine Road, for example, in the northern part of the city and around Dunkerin Gardens, walls that have been up for decades. So there is progress, you know, from local communities where they are kind of incentivized and want the walls to come down. In other parts of the city, things are still much more contentious. Communities are still probably suspicious of one another to a certain extent. There's less communication across the peace lines. And, you know, particularly in the area that I was focusing on today, along Cooper Way, it's going to be interesting to see what the timeline of that structure is going to be moving into the future. I think only very recently the communities on either side of that wall have started getting together to try and think about what might happen in that space in the years and, I guess, decades to come. But I imagine it's going to be, you know, a quite a long-term process, trying to untangle this kind of labyrinth in the city.
I was also thinking about the image that you showed with the Berlin Wall, the Palestine Wall, and the peace walls all together. And it's kind of powerful with the very difference in scale. Why do you think that the other two examples have so much more notoriety than the peace walls?
It's a curious question, isn't it? I mean, I've given a number of lectures now about the peace walls and so on. And the first thing that people say to me is that I thought there was only one peace wall. So there seems to be a real lack of understanding about the number and extent of the peace walls in cities and, you know, towns and parts of the countryside in Northern Ireland. A lot of people think they were taken down as part of the peace process, and they don't actually realize that they are still up, you know, in various parts of the country. I don't know. In terms of notoriety, I think it's interesting. I don't know why. I mean, you certainly have a lot of people visiting the peace walls in Belfast, and it's become a kind of tourist attraction in its own right, in a way. But I think there's a certain, how would you say, like the city fathers are not necessarily invested in advertising the fact that they have these walls in the city. It's very much locally generated tours and walks that happen and so on. if you go into the Northern Ireland Tourist Board headquarters in Belfast city centre, you're not going to see a single peace wall. You know, so there's I would say, as a kind of investment in obscuring the fact that they're still around in the media and so on.
Like, even you said that growing up in Ireland, you were shocked by the scale of the walls when you actually saw them in real life.
Absolutely, yes.
Even growing up in the, like, in a more local context. We've got a question from Christian. I'm just going to unmute you now. You should be, hang on. I did unmute you and then you're unmuted now.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, James, for that presentation. And I've heard you present a couple of times, but this was the first time that I've seen you present specifically or with this focus on that one particular False Shankill area. And it's interesting because I also know that this proposition that you're kind of working toward is a more or less recent development. So I'm quite interested in the way that you narrated that trajectory, the history leading up into this proposition. And the thing that I found really, really interesting and evocative is the focus on materiality throughout. And with that, a kind of sense of a growing opacity in the division. And I was really particularly struck when you showed the map that had all the names that then become really, really dense in that one boundary condition. And it really, that's where it kind of really strikes home what the implications are of that boundary. But I guess I might, that's kind of a description of what you've done, but my interest is in the proposition that you are arriving at the end, and you were using terms like suturing. And I'm wondering if you could talk a bit about how you envision the quality, the material quality of this possible future wall, and perhaps thinking about that in relation to the capacity of it to suture, perhaps retaining a need for some of the opacity that it's developed over time.
Okay, so I mean, the materiality of the peace walls generally, and certainly the one I've been focusing on today, is really one of, you know, a movement from a kind of transparency into like a kind of profound opacity, where even the horizon and, you know, the local hills and so on, all human contact, all even, you know, an ability to be able to see the adjacent houses and so on is completely denied across the peace wall divide. So somehow, I mean, trying to scale that back and almost try and perforate some of that opacity, I think, is a really seen as a really positive thing. And even like the very first change for years and years in Lanark Way, where they changed that really heavy opaque metal gate into something that's transparent, was seen as something profoundly positive, despite the fact that it's still operating as a wall. There's still a gate there, as there has been for years. But somehow the transparency and the ability to see through and to actually see the community on the other side is important. So I've been trying to think about, you know, there are medical analogies, but trying to kind of puncture and suture and, you know, make certain openings, and trying to think about looking at the map, because over time there's such a distinct kind of division. Even the roads that connect the formerly connected areas have been completely truncated and so on. So I'm trying to look at very distinct spaces on either side that could potentially use as sites to try and connect through. And I mean, initially I just thought, you know, all of these walls need to be completely taken down immediately. When I started looking at this whole kind of project, that was my intention, was to say they need to be taken down. Let's try and kind of accelerate how that can happen as much as possible. And it's only just more recently, I think perhaps looking at like the, you know, the Berlin Wall, of course, was almost completely erased, but you know, the how you can kind of understand the history of the Berlin Wall now in spaces in Berlin, I think is an incredibly useful educational opportunity. Mm-hmm. And it's only recently I've been trying to really think about the heritage value of some of these things, almost as like monumental artifacts in the city that probably do need to be, you know, treated in that kind of light in some way. Mm-hmm. So that there is a possibility perhaps of maybe in retaining and enclosing certain parts of the walls within a larger architectural framework that could actually tell the story of what happened there and maybe provide a kind of interesting, you know, history and opportunities for learning, I think, about spaces of conflict, you know, elsewhere in the world.
Thank you so much, James. I think we're just at time, so I think we'll wrap up there. But thank you everyone for joining. Thank you for being part of the programme, James. Next up, we have Andrew Berman, who's a New York-based architect, who's at 7 p.m. And at 9 p.m. we have Lucinda Rogers reading a bedtime story over on our Instagram page. So I'm going to unmute everyone for a round of applause, and I'll play us out with some more of the stiff little fingers.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to explain the choice first of
the music. I was asked to put a piece of music on, and I went for Stiff Little Fingers, who are a punk band from Belfast. And during the course of the Troubles, punk gigs and Stiff Little Fingers gigs particularly were renowned as a space where it didn't really matter whether you were from one particular part of the city or another. It was a kind of genuinely shared space for the enjoyment of music. And I actually met the drummer of the Stiff Little Fingers on my travels around Belfast about a year ago, and he was an incredible guy. So yeah, let's play out with Alternative Ulster.